Hello.
Good evening, everyone. We are starting with 10-minute delay. Don't worry, it was part of the plan. We won't miss the dinner, which is after this panel. We have another panel dedicated to the future of Europe, but this time around, we are going to be examining the question of our common values. My name is Matej. I'm a professor of European law and the rector of the new university in Ljubljana, Slovenia. And it's my great honor to be here with you today, and especially when in company of such excellent speakers. And the weather couldn't be better outside, right? I'm sure that you would all agree that we have already had a fantastic day of exchanges, dialogues, and speeches. We have learned a lot, and there has certainly been so much food for thought. And as I already mentioned, the dinner is a little bit after 8, and if anything, this panel has to be conducted and finished in good time. And therefore, it means we'll proceed straight down to the business. Today, I'm joined by 7 outstanding thinkers coming from different influential corners of public life with impressive careers in that or another way dedicated to studying, researching, influencing, and governing what is presently known as the European Union. And let me start introducing them in the alphabetic order. We have today with us Mr. Benjamin Haddad, who's a director of Atlantic Council Europe, Gašper Dovžan, who's a state secretary at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Slovenia, Ms. Shada Islam, who's a managing director at the New Horizons project, Mr. Guillaume Klossa, a founding president of EuropaNova. As a digital speaker, that is via Zoom, we'll be joined by Professor Dr. Kalypso Nicolaïdis, who's a professor of international relations at the University of Oxford, and since some months, also a professor at the European University Institute in Florence. Then there is Ms. Maria João Rodrigues, president of the European Foundation of Progressive Studies, and last but not least, Dr. Žiga, a professor from the University of Ljubljana and academic council member at the Wilfried Martens Center for European Studies. It is with these speakers that we are going to address the question of common values, which is one of the main, indeed prerequisite ingredient for the future of the European Union. In my opinion, any union, the European Union included, requires common values that should play at least 3 roles. The common values are the alpha, they are the omega of the integration process, and at the same time, they are also a measure of legitimacy of this integration process. Common values have to be in place at the very beginning to get the integration process started. Common values are the object and purpose of the integration, the goods that we value, that we want to foster, that we want to maximize, that we want to optimize in our internal and external relations. And to the extent we actually do that, to the extent that the given integration process lives up to the declared values, this is also then a sign, a measure, a benchmark against which we measure the legitimacy and finally the viability of the integration process. And when it comes to the European Union, and as we also heard this morning and throughout the day, there have been many commitments expressed towards common values, that means that in the European Union, things, as with regard to common values, couldn't be more simple. The common, indeed our common fundamental values, are proclaimed already in Article 2 of the Treaty on the European Union, which reads as follows. I quote, "The Union is founded on the values of respect for human dignity, freedom, democracy, equality, the rule of law, and respect for human rights. including the rights of persons belonging to minorities. These values are common to the member states in a society in which pluralism, non-discrimination, tolerance, justice, solidarity, and equality between women and men prevail. End of quote. This provision stands at the very beginning of the Treaty of Lisbon, this Article 2 of the Treaty on the European Union. And for a long time, the substance of the just quoted Article 2 has been considered as nothing more as a mere truism. These were our common values. They were written down in the constitutions of EU member states. They were written down in the constitutions of the candidate states, those who wanted to become the members of the European Union. So these common values were declaratorily set in constitutional stone, and they have been also, ideally at least, implemented in practice. But, there always is a but. But then something happened. For more than a decade now, among the many disputes and conflicts and crises that we have had in the European Union, the commonness of the common values seems to be put in the question too. The value cleavages appear to be many. They run on the axis from the north to the south, and in particular from the west to the east. The language in which these cleavages are expressed is getting more and more complex, more and more colorful. It is getting richer, but it's getting stronger too. For example, EU is, for example, divided by those who have supported economic austerity, who are more frugal, and they are normally in the north, as opposed to those who have championed economic solidarity and tend to be in the south. The EU is split between those who support more or less solidarity towards migrants. The migratory currents, in many respects truly unprecedented, have also rekindled the interest in our way of life, in the position of Islam in Europe, and the very character of the so-called Christian Europe. Finally, this has in some corners, with the main protagonist in one of the countries of Central Europe, led to a proposed paradigm shift from liberal democracy, based on liberal values, to illiberal democracy, advocating conservative, collective values in the name of Christian Europe and preservation of nation and families as its basic constitutive unit. To some extent, the value cleavages, in particular in terms of the rule of law, have run so deep that one could even speak of about a veritable Kulturkampf, especially on the axis between the West and the East. So, against this backdrop, it is the purpose of this panel to help us understand the just sketched out problematic, but also and preferably draw our attention to some possible solutions. And let me therefore get started by giving the floor to the panelists. My idea is to proceed in three rounds. I have prepared some questions for two rounds, whereas in the third round, I would like to open the floor and engage you, the audience, to address our speakers directly with your question. I'm looking at my back, whether Professor Nicolaïdis is with us, because I would like to posit the first question to her. There. Ah, there you are. Ah, there you are. Hi, Kalypso. Thank you for being with us, even if just as a digital speaker. We have agreed among the panelists that we should limit our interventions to 5 minutes, so that we have these two rounds of exchanges to say as much as we can. So, Kalypso, I would like to pose a hard question to you, and that is, why is it that we have these value conflicts in the European Union today? And what are they actually about? Are they true disagreements about the very fundamentals in the European Union? Or is there maybe just a political foul play? That we have a political use and abuse of the reasonable value differences in our societies for short-term or maybe even long-term gains on the national and European level. What's your opinion?
First of all, let me apologize for not being physically present with you in the beautiful Bled. And I very much am committed to coming back next year. But this is really a fundamental issue for our Europe, as you were describing very well. And at stake is exactly what you said, the Kulturkampf. The fact that in the world today, we have a systems competition, a competition between political systems, not just China versus the West, but in a much broader sense. And so the first answer to your question is perhaps that different countries in Europe or peoples don't have the same sense of what's at stake, why values are the heart of geopolitics. It's a very French thing, it's a very British thing. It's a Baltic state thing. I think countries in the Balkans in Southeast Europe understand this very well, but other countries in the center of Europe might not see this that way. Now, the second point is maybe a small disagreement with what you were saying, because most countries do not see common values or as the object of integration. No, integration is about interests. And interests and values don't always go together, at least as defined by the government of the day, or more structurally by different sensitivities and cultures. If we feel that our interest is to limit absolutely the number of migrants in our country, then we can hear other countries jump up and down and saying solidarity, but that's not gonna make a dent on our sense, we can put the country we want there, of our interest. So I think that those two reasons are very fundamental. You might add much more metaphysical or cultural reasons. You alluded to Christian Europe. And there are countries, including one of my countries, I'm French, British, and Greek, so in Greece, many do believe in Christian Europe, just like in Hungary. But at the same time, I draw on the very culture of my native Greece to say, you know what? There is another slightly different understanding of European values, which we could call Cretan Europe, not Christian, but the island of Crete, where the goddess Europe was taken by Zeus as a bull. And that Cretan Europe, symbolizes movement, symbolizes being quite a foreigner. She was from Lebanon. So Europe is made of its others. Europe is moving. Europe has fluid boundaries. That's another Cretan Europe, very different from a much more closed and static and passéist understanding of Christian Europe. And we could go on, and my colleagues will say more. But can I add, Thomas, that I think that we are facing three sins of the European value narrative. There is the sin of parochialism, simply to think that these are European values, or if they're universal, that we are better at enforcing them. There is a second sin, which is the sin of inconsistency and mean. We don't put the means to the end. Whether we're trying to build a creative democracy, and that's the other panel that is meeting at the same time as ours, in Bled, whether we're saying that we're innovating with democracy, but not, or whatever we do internally, Schengen, supposedly open borders, but our closed border inside, outside, our interventions, inconsistency. And the third sin is, of course, hypocrisy. And I would just suggest for the rest, because we're going to continue this discussion on what is to be done, that there's many different ways of trying to manage this bounded morality that we have. Morality is always bounded. You're not going to sacrifice all of your interests for values if they clash. But if we have bounded morality, it starts with taking in the point of view of others, and it starts with all sorts of ways in which we can address in pragmatic way these inconsistencies, and I'll be happy to come back to that in the next discussion.
putting in front of us the three original sins of parochialism, inconsistency, and hypocrisy. Žiga, what do you make of the deliberately, I provoked a little bit, I put this word Kulturkampf on the table. Would you say that we are